pool of...
This is where
Matty O.W.
unraveled the mysteries of
AIM training.
This is the birthplace of
AIM.
For sure, everyone knows reactive tracking. It's one of the six primary categories on every AIM training benchmark. But did you know that this one category is actually its own spectrum? On one end of the range, we have standard reactive tracking. This includes well-known scenarios like air and ground plaza. These are foundational scenarios that have been around for almost as long as COVAX and have provided immense value since their creation. Yet, on the other end of the spectrum, as the difficulty and evasiveness of the boss in each scenario increase, reactive tracking turns into pure reactivity. Pure reactivity, as a category, includes the more difficult reactive scenarios, most notably LDDH. My followers definitely know that I recommend LDDH variants frequently. This is because of how different it is in nature compared to other ground tracking variants. Not only is the scenario much harder than ground plaza, but it requires a much different approach, one that we've already seen. Now, to clear up confusion, I must admit that calling scenarios pure reactivity is somewhat misleading, because pure reactivity is not really a category. It is an approach, a specific technique used to play these specific reactive tracking scenarios. Everything we're discussing within this video falls under the one category title of reactive tracking, but we just need different labels for whether a scenario can be played in the standard way or if it can be played purely reactively. Let's begin by talking about the path a new player might take to understanding this category. Through this, we can better understand the development of specific techniques along the way. Let's assume that a new player to AIM training would gravitate towards the voltaic benchmarks. They'll play reactive tracking in the form of relatively easy air and ground variants. What makes these easier is that they feature bots that are much larger and slower. This makes it easier for new players to get used to movement reading. At this stage, players who struggle with reactive tracking may also struggle with smoothness. If they cannot match the target's speed well enough or react sluggishly, or if they react too quickly in such that they overflick, it will hurt their score. If you are at the stage and trying to improve with these early variants, you must simply focus on training stability and getting your movement reading skills up to par. This means grinding tracking scenarios on evasive bots. You could try playing invincible versions that acclimate you to singular bot patterns for longer periods of time. At this point, you just need to grind and learn. Focused thought and practice will bring some players to a much higher playing field. The advanced section of reactive tracking will usually feature the standard bot patterns for high-level AIM training. It is at this point that previously simple concepts of stability, speed matching, and smoothly recovering become integral to the process and automatic. However, movement reading at this level becomes much harder. Because of quicker bot movements, you need to find opportunities to make space for recoveries. This is where you must employ edge tracking. Edge tracking, sometimes referred to as under-aiming or undershooting, means to place your cursor intentionally off of center mass while tracking your reactive target, specifically on the following edge of the bot. This means that if the bot is strafing right, you will follow the bot on its left edge, and if it's strafing left, then you will follow its right edge. What this does is create more space for a good recovery by maximizing your time on target during a strafe direction change. This is because, since you are on the following edge of the bot, when the bot changes its direction, it will pass through your crosshair. You will still stay on target during the time it takes for you to react to the direction change and recover the track. For most players' AIM training careers, this is as far as one will go. However, as standards for AIM training increase, and as players continue to press themselves towards a higher difficulty, you will inevitably run into scenarios like LDDH. What makes LDDH so different? Well, for one thing, it is a mix of many complex, fast movements. It's almost impossible to hold a steady track on the bot for a long period of time. Also, most importantly, LDDH bots do not have movement acceleration and deceleration, which means there is no indication of the next bot direction change. I personally found this scenario almost unplayable the first time I tried it, but after learning what I needed to do to play it correctly, I could confidently say that LDDH gave me the keys to understanding pure reactivity. Perhaps a better way I should have transitioned myself into these scenario types is through RA reactivity, specifically strafe track, reactive sphere, and leap track. Strafe track specifically is a much easier version of LDDH. Once again, viewing the category of reactive tracking as a spectrum, these scenarios, along with Fugla track variants and blink track, fall into the middle of the range. It is common thought that, well, since these scenarios are simply more difficult and evasive, wouldn't it be viable to emphasize more on the concepts reinforced by advanced tracking, i.e. edge tracking and pattern reading? Well, no. Because of how fast these bots move, with no acceleration, random blinks, and in seemingly perfectly random patterns, trying to apply common advice and these well-known techniques falls apart. Edge tracking will prove useless. Instead, you simply need to try for any long period of time on target that you can possibly get. The reason why most players fail to do this is because of predicting. Predicting is a bad habit that forms out of too much trust in predictable bot patterns. What this looks like most of the time is a player that is reacting to a bot strafe that never occurs. Other times, it manifests when a bot is in a very long strafe and the player begins to shake off of the current strafe in the opposite direction, expecting some kind of non-existent direction change. Other times, it just looks like poor speed matching and preemptive motion changes. The reason why this fails in scenarios like strafe track is because these bots are so evasive, so seemingly random, and often much smaller. So not only is there much more room for failure in a prediction, but failures also hurt your score so much more. But predicting, at least mentally, is a part of movement reading. So does this mean that movement reading goes out the window with these scenarios? Well, if you look at it through the perspective of a certain reactive player, say, Mad Batman, that would be a reasonable conclusion. Mad Batman does not believe in reading bot movements, which makes sense for these types of scenarios. His approach to them is pure reactivity. It is the very brute force, rigid, snappy-looking kind of aim that minimizes time off target by simply reacting to and syncing your motions with bot strafes. Pure reactivity is exactly what it sounds like. No fancy techniques, no abusing a pattern, just good old-fashioned reaction in any direction. Now obviously, this isn't realistic because every scenario always has a pattern that can be exploited to some degree. It's the same thing with real games. Any player will have tendencies and movement that can be exploited. There is no pure randomness with these kinds of things, and if there were, it wouldn't really make for a good scenario. Nonetheless, pure reactivity scenarios have been coined as MBM reactive, due to his connection with Aimbeast, the only place where scenarios at this far end of the spectrum can be found. This includes crazy scenarios like God Ball, Close FS, and Passive Track Evo. They take the concepts reinforced by LDDH and run with it. They're the hardest form of reactive tracking that can be possibly found in any aim training environment, at least currently. And realistically, they should be at the end of any path that a new player would take through aim training. Pure reactivity and reactive tracking have different applications when you go to make the in-game translation. It is critical that you understand these applications and mappings when you decide which to prioritize. This next segment will discuss that in detail.
Hi, I'm Seba. For those of you who don't know me, I'm an aim trainer player, and I'm mostly known for my reactive tracking scores. Outside of aim trainers, my main game is Overwatch. For reference, over my 7 years of playing it, I have around 3,000 hours in Overwatch, and earlier this season, I was ranked 61 on DPS. I mainly played Soldier and Tracer to get there. Overwatch arguably has the highest pure reactivity requirement out of any popular FPS game, and this is due to the fundamental nature of the game engine used by Overwatch. Movement in the Overwatch engine is completely different from almost every other popular FPS game in one incredibly crucial way. Unlike games like Apex or CSGO, Overwatch has instant acceleration. This means instead of taking a small amount of time to ramp up to your max velocity when moving in-game, you instantly start moving at your max speed whenever you press a movement key in Overwatch. Instant acceleration, or instant accel for short, might seem like a minuscule thing, but in reality it has pretty massive implications when it comes to aiming. In a game with gradual acceleration, like Apex Legends, you have a small window of opportunity to read a target's movement whenever they change directions. This window of opportunity occurs when the target's velocity differs from their max speed, right? If somebody starts decelerating in Apex Legends, that means they've just started strafing in the opposite direction. If you're able to consistently notice this in-game, it makes it relatively easy to read movement. As Maddie has previously discussed, a game like Apex Legends focuses more on general reactive tracking than pure reactivity for the simple reason. In a game like Overwatch, it's completely different. Instant acceleration eliminates the window of opportunity for reading strafes. This turns situations that would involve general reactive tracking into situations that exclusively rely on pure reactivity. Another additional layer of complexity is added by the plethora of movement abilities that exist in Overwatch, like Tracer's Blink, or Soldier's Sprint, or Cassidy's Roll, or Ball's Grapple, or D.Va's Thrusters, or Monkey's Jump, or Rein's Charge, etc. Granted, with all this being said, there actually are a small handful of abilities in Overwatch that have gradual acceleration, like Wrecking Ball's ball form, and there even are some individual heroes that have gradual acceleration as a part of their base movement, because either they don't touch the ground, or they have like a weird form of movement like Lucio or Ekka. Now, over my thousands of hours of playtime, I've learned a couple of neat tricks that make the high pure reactivity requirement of Overwatch, as well as instant acceleration aim trainer scenarios, much easier to manage. The first, and arguably the most important, is based around how your eyes focus on targets. Aim as a whole is an extension of hand-eye coordination. The physical adjustments you make with your mouse are the quote-unquote hand part of the equation, so what is the eye part of the equation then? Well, in normal reactive tracking scenarios, reading the movement of the target is the eye component. In pure reactivity scenarios, it's similar, but slightly different. Instead of hard focusing the velocity of a target like you would when reading acceleration, you soft focus your eyes around the target with a bias towards where the target is likely to move. For instance, if a target is standing on high ground with only cover to their left and they're strafing right, it's very likely that the target will change direction and attempt to strafe towards cover, so you should soft focus your eyes to the left of the target despite the target's current direction of movement. I know this might sound kind of counterintuitive, so let me provide a visual example of me putting this into practice. That's one dead hold. Okay, I know that was a little too fast for you guys to really see what was happening, so let's slow down a little bit while I explain. So as soon as I see the Ashe start strafing towards the open, coverless high ground, my eyes focus in the opposite direction towards cover, because I know she's probably going to strafe that way. But yeah, that's all I have to say for now. Thank you so much, Mandy, for letting me do this segment of the video.
And that concludes this episode of Unraveling the Secrets of Aim. Thank you, Siba, for providing your thoughts on reactivity and reactive tracking and the category of pure reactivity. Stay tuned for the next one, guys, and I hope this helped.